I can shorten my talk because everything was said already before. You know how IPv6 prefixes are changed. And I'm going to explain in this talk why we are doing this. First of all, without the slides, you all know IPv6 is the root of evil. Everything goes wrong with the time IPv6 was introduced. IPv6 is the root of all privacy problems in the internet. Simply, if you're looking at the timeline, we have an internet where everybody trusts everybody. We have protocols like FTP, we have Telnet. We have a lot of clear text messages and nobody got harmed. And then by the time IPv6 was introduced, a lot of people start to claim about privacy, about security. So we can clearly say from the historical perspective, IPv6 is the root of all evil. Bitte? Ja. Also mich stört es nicht, du kannst ja rebooten, so viel du möchtest. Okay, so let's back to the root of all evil. Ich bin ein Mauspointer, wo ich bin ein Mauspointer, da? Das macht, ich habe nicht drauf gedrückt bis jetzt. Jedenfalls nicht versucht. Soll ich nochmal drücken? Nee, die sputen gerade, das wird nichts. Okay. There are two parts because IPv6 is the evil for all privacy problems. The first one is the standard. The standard introduced a method to, oh, fine. Well. Okay. Fine. Fine. The standard introduced the main problem. It includes the MAC address in the public visible IP address, so everybody knows the device which is talking in the internet and makes it very easy to track users. We got privacy extensions, but it was late add-on, so in all add-ons, you know, it's a bug fix and will not be rolled out in the wide area. That's why we have the problem still, always. And even if you do this, we have the problem with the providers. They are assigned a fixed prefix, and a fixed prefix means you can track the users. So we have privacy problems. What we are doing in response to this problem is we hand out multiple prefixes. You know how prefixes are rolled. We have one prefix, which is currently used for new connections, so it had a preferred lifetime which is greater than zero. And in order to keep the old TCP sessions and everything else, we hand out the prefix that was previously used for new connections. And then, that's the important point, we hand out a third prefix, which contains a static prefix, has a preferred lifetime of zero, so it will not be used for new connections, but has a very long valid lifetime. Let's have a look how it works. First, we have the order is important. The order of prefix in messages are important. If you have a broken device, it always uses the first prefix. So your real dynamic prefix has to come first. First, the real working prefix has a valid lifetime, for instance, for 1 day. A valid lifetime for 2 days and is preferred for 1 day. Every time we get a DHCP response, we adjust the value so that we have a fixed timing where we want to change prefixes. We hand out the old prefix and we hand out a static prefix. If you see this on the client PC, somewhere in the network, we will see three IP addresses for the client. One is used for new connections, one is used for the existing connections, and one could be used to add into the DNS. It's reachable. Now, how to choose such prefixes and how to rotate them. We rotate once an hour our dynamic prefixes for the customers in DSL networks. So the valid lifetime is at most 2 hours. Fritzbox from AVM is able, but it doesn't do it always, to make a rewind event and saying, there's a prefix which is going to valid lifetime zero, but we have still open connections. Can you please give a little bit extended time and we can respond to it? Usually, that does not happen very often. Usually, IPv6 connections are very short from DSL customers. They do not last over many hours. In order to keep the such requests answered and we do not reuse the prefixes too much, we add 4 bits for timing. So we have time 1 hour, zero, one, two, three, four. So we have 16 hours in the prefix space we can use for choosing prefixes. And we need to have a minimum prefix size, and we have to put it down. We can't hand out /65 or /48 to the customers because we hand out a lot of prefix. We have a lot of prefix per customer simultaneously out. So we are going to as low as possible, and as low as possible means /60. That means if we have 16 hours, and we have a little bit space for randomizations, we need a lot of IPv6 space for doing rotation. Okay. And that, of course, we need a large pool for static prefixes. And how does it work? First, we did it for PPP. That was very simple because we could extract the DHCP requests from the FreeBSD interface, which was created for the PPP session, and we could inject the packets into the on the same using IP firewall and the word interface. Everything's fine on this. Then we tried to do it on DHCP, on normal large layer 2 domain. It doesn't work. Simply doesn't work. Because if you have a DSLAM, DSLAMs are notoriously badly configured from network perspective. They are configured to do telecommunication, not networking. You should connect, the customer should connect to a service, not to another customer. It's not the intention. And all the configuration is made, the design of these boxes are made to prevent the customer talking to a customer. So we had a lot of filters. We can't get broadcast through. We can send broadcast from the network side to the customer and will not reach the customer. We can send multicast, it will not reach the customer. And we do, if we do not have multicast, we do not have ICMPv6, and if we do not have ICMPv6, we do not have neighbor discovery, and if we do not have neighbor discovery, we do not have IPv6 at all. What happens? Thanks to AVM, if they don't see a router advertisement or anything like this, it's multicasted. Like we have here in the room for the VLAN, doesn't reach you. And the Fritzbox is what's questioned yesterday. They are doing very simple thing. Nevertheless, they send the DHCP solicit request and say, give me IPv6 addresses. That's fine, because this request reaches us. And we can respond to it, but doesn't work. Simply because the router, which is relaying the request, can't send the request the response back, simply because they had no neighbor discovery and doesn't know which MAC address to use in order to send the response back. What we are doing is, we got such a DSLAM, we got the documentation for the DSLAM. We read it, find out there is an option to enable it, but we can't roll it out because carrier say we do not make a change without multiple year lag. What we are doing is we are faking ARP requests for a long time, so we are faking neighbor discovery requests for a long time because we do not have any information. We use the EUE embedding of MAC addresses and ARP addresses to reconstruct the original MAC address and faking neighbor discovery response. Source code is available. We say simply that we are coming from a router that has a special area of link local addresses, and so we can distinguish between customer to customer or router to customer. I can use an AUE solicitation, and that's fine. If you hand it out, it did it on the weekend. In the network, which was blocked, we got 260 customers online. We got the routes into the network, and we had the prefixes to the customer. And the interesting point, we have real IPv6 traffic in the layer 2 domain, which is blocked multicast. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lutz. Are there any questions?